question, Bill. He said you're probably just a sponge.
Hold on. The video froze. Story.
When I first did my permaculture course, my PDC with Bill in 1983, I kind of left the course a skeptic, and I didn't say a word, I didn't ask a question, and Bill told me later when I told him that I was a bit feeling guilty. So I didn't ask a question. He said, "You're probably just a sponge."
Video's not working. I thought it would work. I don't know why it's not working. I'm kind of pissed off.
It's literally an introduction. An introduction to the subject, really. And kind of the more important part of the intro is after you get past the responsibility stage where we all need to take responsibility for our own existence and the existence of the future generations. So it's a responsibility introduction, really. It goes into then how we have to really energy audit things and how society would look. And I don't think we can really fully understand how society would look if it was a permaculture society everywhere outside. But it introduces that sort of thing. And when you're looking at this book, when you're trying to read this book, it's really hard. It's a manual. He called it a manual. Right? He could have called it all kinds of things. People do give it unusual names, but he called it a manual, like a manual for a car or a manual for an appliance. You don't go to bed at night and read a manual. Well, some of you might, but you don't read a manual, right? From cover to cover. It doesn't make a lot of sense anyway. It's so full of information, it's so information dense. If you read one sentence, it's like reading a paragraph. You read one paragraph, it's like reading a chapter. You read one chapter, it's like reading a small book. So what it is a manual for design science as an earth repair system. So you've got to know where you are in the manual. You've got to know that if you're going to work on the brakes, you don't want to be reading a section on the engine. If you're reading about the steering of a car, you don't want to be reading about the brakes. You know, you've got to know where you are in the manual. So it's very carefully written. There's a sequence that he wrote. And every single chapter, even the order of the chapters and the names of the chapters have great relevance. And
this guy's kind of crazy.
At the names of the chapters and thinking about why he named those chapters is one thing. It's a very good key, very good trick. Think about that very deeply. But another key into this book is to look at the back of most of the chapters. Not all the chapters, but most of the chapters have a principal summary at the back of the chapter or a designer's checklist. So go to the back of each chapter and read that first. If you understand that, that's the key into the chapter. That's what I tell my students anyway. It's a way into understanding the book.
Now, I don't remember anything.
After chapter one, the introduction, the next chapter is the big one. And everybody wants you to jump into the third chapter, which is methods of design. But the second chapter is concepts and themes.
It's actually less than I was expecting.
Where there is the largest principle summary. That is the foundation, really, of the book. It's where you lay down the concepts and the themes of design itself. When you go into production, you go into yields, you go into products, you go into niches.
Looks like my video stopped again.
Mm-hmm. to actually define what really is a yield, what really is a product, what are the foundations of the subject, why, what are the themes of the concept. It's literally that. It gives you a true grounded. It's definitely the most serious of all the chapters. It's the one you really need to understand, because it lays down those foundations of why we need to design. So I think that is, for me, the most important chapter in the whole course that I teach.
Oh my God.
The concepts and themes of design. People want to rush through it. They want to get out of there fast. They want to get into how. How do we do it? And that's the next chapter. So once you, if you hold people back, if you say, look, let's reread this one. Let's restudy the concepts and themes.
$100?
Let's really start to understand.
This has got to be a joke.
What are those main frames of design?
Unbelievable.
Because the next chapter, the methods of design, is one of the smallest designers' checklists. It's reasonably simple how we approach. There's only so many ways that we approach with a method of designing. And the one that's most common is we simply analyze the situation. We go through slope. We go through orientation. Which way are we facing on the compass? And we go through the use of elements and the positioning of elements for their energy efficiency planning, what we call zonal placement. And we go out to then sectors of design. And that is the most common approach, the analysis. But it also goes into observational design, how we just observe from observations, almost like an indigenous way of designing. How we look at events around us and start to analyze the events over a period of time. And often we don't have time to do that as consultants. We're time poor in the modern world. We don't have time reference. Our time is often very low quality and we're very short of time. So it's almost a meditative state that one has to get into to see relevant elements as you're walking through landscape when you're not really arguing between your left brain and your right brain. You're getting yourself into a zone where you're literally just receiving information. And when something pulls you out of that meditative state, you then reference it, come back and examine that later. So indigenous people often say, or traditional people often say, Westerners, modern people, don't sit still long enough to ask the right question. So that's observational. Then Bill talks about that random assembly of lists. A lot of people don't take that seriously, but the random assembly of lists is really where we put down an assembly of elements that we intend to include in design, and then we cross-reference. So we look at the major lists and their subsets, and the other major lists and their subsets, and we just randomly cross with no particular rhyme or reason. Just, are we missing something? We've got so used to seeing a reductionist, simplified landscape. We've got so used to being told that our efficiency comes out of singular elements that are machinery maintained and simplified into mass production on singular time zones, instead of our expanded time throughout a design. We're really designers of time space as well as physical space. We don't just stack elements, physical elements into a design. We stack time into a design. The classic book, The One Straw Revolution by Fukuoka, was really such a classic because he stacked time into a rice field by crossing crop zones of time and linking them together with a perennial clover. He stacked time simply, but we've taken that whole concept a lot further, that we stack time into large perennial elements. We allow our systems to demonstrate their evolutions through that time stacking as well. So quite often we're never quite sure what we're going to get, except it's going to get better, it's going to get more diverse, definitely going to get more interesting. So when you have a random assembly of lists, then you're really opening up possibilities. You're being very open to what might not have seemed obvious initially, because we're so used to walking around in a simplified landscape. Now, that really takes us through the main methods of design. A lot of it is quite common sense, and then some of it is where you've just literally got to trust yourself that this is not so common an approach. Some of it's analysis, some of it almost seems like a game, and some of it seems like your trust in your intuition. You're actually making a bit of a guess. By the time you get to that stage, you're actually entitled to make a bit of a guess. It's very rare that people do that careful analysis. So you've come a long way at that stage. So your designing is now just about to take one more leap, because you're in chapter 3, and at the end of chapter 3, methods of design, you jump into chapter 4. And chapter 4 is, it's really ours, this one. Uh-huh. This is the one the universities would probably throw out if they took our curricula and dissected it into different departments. Chapter 4, pattern, understand it. That's literally the title. It's not just patterns, it's pattern, understand it. So, chapter 4 is really the glue. It really stands us alone. We're very different on that one element, that chapter 4. When we start to look at the patterns around us, from the micro to the macro, we're looking at the expressions in the universe of how energy is expressed in physical form. We're looking at the capturing of energy and its expression, no matter how large or small we want to look at it. And at the point that you get the pattern and you start to explain what patterns are, they're simplified form. They're very, very simple forms. And not so many forms, but an infinite number of slight imperfections. You start to open people's understanding there. The links that we make between elements that cooperate with natural patterns, it's really the clincher on the start of the understanding. It's the clinching element. I'm way in front of my slideshow here. So when you get to chapter 4, people are starting to then realize there is something very special. There's something very special about this set of understanding. It's only through understanding the patterns are expressed through energy efficiency in natural systems. The simplification of really everything that's around us into understanding the basic patterns of the universe, and it doesn't matter how large, and it doesn't matter how small. As a teacher, it's usually your students that let you know from their design work, from their questions, what it is you're not getting across right. Pattern is one of those subjects that you either get it or you don't get it. When you get it, you never lose it. People say, I suddenly got it. I suddenly realized. It's like riding a bike. All of a sudden you can ride. And you never forget to ride again. So suddenly you feel the motion, you're in there. You've got this pattern understanding. Now, something that's often left out, that's not expressed enough, is the order of size. natural orders of size. And we have expressions that say, in language, say, we're out of order. And we are. We are out of order. The orders of scale of size relevant within our design patterning is something we have to concentrate on. Bill references it very clearly in the manual. He talks about orders of size between 5 and 9. There are no orders of size less than 5. There are no orders greater than 9 in anything in the known universe. Very rarely do people emphasize that quite enough, or then quote exactly how that works. We don't know why it works. We don't know why it's those numbers. But they're all around us as reference. Once you realize that, you realize you're designing within those orders. You're looking at the orders of everything that you're applying. You realize why the zones come in orders of size too. You realize why the smaller, the zone 1 to the zone 5 increase in size. There are 5 zones, between 5 and 9 again. Everything we look at, the skeleton of the body, is a 7 or a 6 if you don't count the backbone, down to the fingers. When you're looking at the larger orders, everything in the larger orders is fewer in number and slower in movement. When we go to the smaller orders of size, they're greater in number and faster in movement. Everything that we look at around us is patterned in a form. So when you're referencing that, you're having to give people examples. Those examples start to change people's actual understanding. They start to realize, this is bigger than I thought. This refers to everything around me. So you're referencing also the pattern of timing, the pattern of sound. You're giving people references of pattern in every dimension. So they start to realize that this is bigger in every way than they thought. This design system applies in more than just the physical, in more than just food supply, in more than just space. It goes out through community itself. It goes out through the patterns of people in community and the patterns of the way we behave.
Oh God, not Grandpa.
So it's a reference point that when we look at our design work, does it fit in with patterns? If it doesn't fit in, if it doesn't come out as harmonic patterns, it's probably going to change itself. It's not going to evolve into something that's complicating itself. It's going to simplify itself into harmonic form.
You
it's going to come backwards,
dick,
instead of going forwards. So, really, when we get to chapter 4, pattern understanding, once we've given people some level of understanding of pattern,
okay, but I don't have any money to buy seeds.
How we apply it, we've really covered the design course.
Yep.
The design course is really in the first chapters between 1 to 4. After pattern, everything is really a reference back to the first 4 chapters. We've got the ability to design at that point. We've got our checking mechanisms. We've got our references. We know how to assemble elements. We know that if we don't get it right, if we don't get design right, what happens is we get chaos. Harmony and chaos we can now reference in relation to pattern assembly. Chaos is when a system is oversupplied with energy that it can't put to productive use. It goes into chaos. right on the edge of chaos is the ultimate opportunity for creative form. We can take our design out and out and out to a point where we step over the chaotic line, pull back one step, we're in the ultimate opportunity for creative form, which we're just back inside the harmonic event. So we play with the edges of form. We occupy and extend the edge. I love the statement. If you're not living on the edge, you're taking up too much space. You're playing with the edge that defines form. And the form that you want is a harmonic form in every way. It's not just the physical patterns. It's the time sequences as well. It's the people sequences that become more and more refined, more and more complex, more and more interesting. That's exactly what happens in natural systems. So at that point, people are kind of exploding with the possibilities. You're referencing all of these things in your mind that you've seen in the past, your life experiences have new meaning, you're starting to refile your desktop in your mind, your right side of your brain's arguing with the left side of the brain about pattern and practicality. You're getting comfortable about sort of left and right switches across the sort of synapses. You're feeling comfortable about being in the middle, in between, when you're doing observational work. You kind of, your brain's sort of excited about all this, but you can't yet focus. You need to focus. And focus starts to come out of the next set of chapters. So you've got the themes, you've got the methods of design, you've got the concepts, you've got themes, you've got the methods of design, you've got the pattern understanding
starting to really come in. Like me,
things are starting to get exciting, but you need to move now into focusing. And what Build has done is,
I love parsnips.
Chapter 5 is climatic factors. And it's so
cauliflowers are the ones that make a lot of money, but
move
we're
to
farmers, so.
Understanding exactly how climate makes a difference.
First.
If you don't know exactly which climate you're in, and there's these major sets of climates and these minor climates, there are climates that are affected by the orographic effect, by landscape itself. Understanding the further you are from an ocean, the more extremes there are over an annual climate, the hotter the summers, the colder the winters, the maritime effect moderating that, the altitude up or even the altitude down, making all the difference. What we'd call today a climate analog, knowing exactly which latitude you're at, what altitude you're at, and what distance from an ocean gives you a starting point. But then are there landscape effects around you like mountain ranges and wind shadows? Where exactly are you? What is it? What landscape are we designing for in relation to climate? Because climate actually shapes most of our landscape forms. So our landscape profiles, which are hard to separate from climate, because the arid lands are definitely an angular shape and the humid landscapes are the rounded shapes. And the volcanic landscapes have a particular shape. Then we have the low islands and the high islands and the flatlands and the wetlands and the coastlands and the estuaries. We have these variations. You've got to identify what they are. The climatic factors start us in that direction. So Bill put that in after pattern because that is a major pattern all around us. That's a pattern that we talk about every day. The weather. So it's very important that we take that extremely seriously as designers. It starts to focus us in.
No.
Now the main interrupter of the energies of the weather, the main element that receives the energy of the weather and pacifies the weather, the one that we are getting more deficient of all the time, is the energy receiving mechanism, the ecosystem. The ecosystem majors in trees and expresses itself ultimately in top predator. A hunting pair of jaguar take 10,000 hectares of Amazon. You've got a hunting pair of jaguar in the Amazon, you've got 10,000 hectares of good quality Amazon. The wolves shape the rivers in the Yellowstone Park here. It's been understood that, aren't we top predator? We appear to be top predator, but we're a top predator that has a choice, it seems. Do we wreck it, or do we bring it back into abundance? Do we take our position, or do we ignore our position? The next chapter after climate factors, NISA and Bill Wright's factors. He wants facts. He's talking facts. Pin it down to the facts. Chapter 5. Chapter 6. It's a lovely sequence. The next sequence, chapter, the next one, is trees and their energy transactions. That's the name of the chapter. Not just trees. It's not about trees necessarily. It's their energy transactions. And the energy they're transacting with is mostly the climate. The input is the climate. The moderating element of our climate. Building that ecosystem major layer, the tree.
What? Come on.
The canopy tree. So it's a very unusual chapter that he put in there. It follows climate exactly. It's the response to climate, or it's the moderator backwards to climate. If you've got it right, our systems moderate the climate through that energy transaction in the tree, in the ecosystem. Ecosystems are massive batteries of life, full of energy, just like a battery is charged with electricity. The first thing he honors is condensation. The first little story he tells is Ocotea photins, the rain trees of the Canary Islands. The Guanche Indians harvested the condensation of those trees as their water supply in the islands where it didn't rain. The one element of trees that's often not counted is the condensation. In the arid lands and the dry lands, where things kind of accentuate pretty extremely, there's such fragile landscapes. The condensation from desert vegetation, from desert trees, can equal 80% of the rainfall. Can be equivalent to 80% in volume of the rainfall. So a treeless desert or a dry land that's been removed of vegetation can have an 80% drop in total precipitation. Precipitation is not just rain. It's however the water is received to the soil. And without the condensated surface, then you don't have the condensation drip. Most the maritime environments are moderated by the condensation from the humidity of the ocean. So if you live near the ocean, you're getting extra condensation. You get condensation every morning. But even out in dry lands, there are times when it's not raining, but there's humidity in the air. And if you have a condensated surface, you've got the drip. You've got the condensating drip. We have to understand that that moderating element harvests and moderates the energy of the climate, the previous chapter. And as you remove it, energy is constant. It's got to go somewhere. It doesn't just disappear. And what we've got is extremely energetic weather. We've got weather that's going in every direction at once. We've got the hottest day, the driest day, the wettest day, the coldest day, for that day on record, everywhere. And you can reference that. You can see that happening. You traditional systems, you can see it in the pattern understanding that people have had of their climate, where they've recorded it with traditions. A lot of those traditions don't work anymore. And those are thousands of years of reference. So the moderation of climate through energy transaction of trees is a very important thing then to understand. So from there, the next chapter, so we go from chapter 6 to chapter 7, is water. One word. That's all he puts, water. From the climate to the trees to the water that's then created and moderated from that event. And everything about water in all its forms. Life is based in water, and the carbon creation from the energy transaction of the trees. It's a sequence that works perfectly then, because you've got some understanding of where you're going. So water is one of the things that has some of the most constants. There are so many expectations out there that there are no real constants, but there are. There are many things that you can reference that are absolutely constant. And water has many, many constants. So it sits perfectly level. It expands when it freezes.
$100.
It keeps itself at a set temperature when you heat it. At a certain point, evaporation cools it. So it stays at 100 degrees centigrade. It won't get any hotter. Condensation warms the air, evaporation cools the air. They're all constants about water. So we can use those constants. When we've got evaporation as a cooling element, we can guarantee that's going to cool. And transpiration off the trees cools the air. Condensation in the early morning warms the air. Water is an element we can design initially as
a priority
of approach. Previous to anything else, previous to zones, previous to sectors, as consultants, the first thing we're looking at is what's the ultimate possibility for water in any design? Not that you might install it, not that you might see it all, but you look optimistically uphill for water. Downhill for heat, but uphill for water, and your water is your priority initially when you're exploring all the possibilities. Water access structures are almost like a mantra of approach prior to anything else.
Boom.
But water takes priority because you can't change the way it behaves.
How many days does this take? 12.
You
okay, we're going to grow cauliflower.
To be more life enhancing. Water is one of the major elements, the major element with carbon created from the trees, from the plants. So coming in that sequence, understand your climate, understand your ecosystem interaction through the energy transaction of trees, then into water, now we can really start the pattern. Water has so many constants in the way you can pattern it out through landscape. But there's different qualities of water. We're looking at wastewater on the outfall and how we clean that up with plant systems, biological cleaning, life cleaning systems, natural cleaning systems on the out. How we capture water in landscape, how we capture water on hard surfaces, how we can provide ourselves with water to drink, water to use, water for our stock, but rehydration of whole landscape. So we're looking at water captured, slowed, used, and as many options as we can to create life events. We're facilitating life events through water. Water is a very important element to that whole chapter. It covers just all the possibilities that we can have for water. So we're in a major priority element there. As we get that right, as we start to get a response from that, what we get in the next subject, the next chapter, is soil.
All right.
Because an indicator that you've got designed right, a very simple one in landscape, is you've created soil. Soil is increasing in quantity and quality. If you're checking your system in the physical form on landscape, soil is one of the best checks. And that's something that agriculture completely fails in and is getting worse. Soil is destroyed, washed away, blown away, degraded in quality, and salted and taken out of production for hundreds, if not 1,000+ years. We have the ability to destroy soils at a faster rate than soil. Again, one word title, right in the middle of the book, the two titles right in the middle, water and soil. From we get out of pattern, we've got there, and we've got climate factors, trees and their energy transactions, water creates, with that together, we've got soil. It's not so much about understanding what soil you've got. There's some discussion of that in the soils chapter. There's some understanding of the organic table of soils. There's a periodic table in there. But it's more the understanding of how do we actually create soil? How do we work with those ecosystems by carbon and water enhancement create better soil? Because soil is our base resource. The larger we go in size, the larger we go in application, the harder it is for us to personally create soil. In a small garden, of course, you can create 1 inch of soil every year. You can create 2 inches of soil a year in a small space. But as soon as you go out in area, then you have to partner with an ecosystem. You have to partner with a soil creative ecosystem. There we have to go way beyond organic. Organic doesn't necessarily mean it's not destroying soils or even not exploiting people. There's some pretty exploitive organic farming going on out there, especially now that it's trendy. I think we have to step past, way past organic. We have to be ecosystemic in our production. We have to be soil creative in our production if we're going to produce surplus.
It's weird, I can't put anything there.
A system that's sustainable produces more energy than it consumes, enough in surplus to maintain and replace that system's components, parts, over their lifetimes. And that's a basic, that's a minimal criteria of sustainability. If you want to trade surplus, you've got to go beyond that. You've got to harvest more energy than is needed to replace and maintain your system, to have surplus to trade. That means you've got to be more soil creative. And the large, if you want to go onto the scale of agriculture we have today, you're going to have major ecosystem elements. Very large. It's got to be a major part of the of large landscape. Otherwise, you just won't make it on the energy audit. So your understanding of soil and its creation, like putting together elements that speed up ecosystem processes, is an extremely important part of understanding how to design. You're now coming more and more in focus, and you're coming back all the time back to the first four chapters in reference. The next chapter is earthworks and earth resources. This is one of my favorites because we start to deal with the big machinery. We start to terraform the landscapes. We start to shape things up.
Yeah,
a lot of time to harvest water, a lot of time to run off water. It's to create hard surface runoff so we don't have problems with water, as well as capturing water, as well as soaking water in. So we're often creating bodies of water, soakages of water for rehydration, and also runoff to make a landscape more hospitable to structures or access ways and services. We start to look at how we design. It's terraforming. It's the reconstructive earth surgery. When you look at the size of the machines we use, if it was a brain surgeon working on your skull, it would be nanosurgery if you're looking at the cranium of the earth. It's actually miniature work. You could hardly see it from a spacecraft. You know, you can see our work from Google Earth just about. So we're also looking at the resources, the earth resources. You're never quite sure what you're going to find when you go down in the ground. Down in that dinosaur country, there's all kinds of resources in the ground. So there are sands, there are gravels, there are clays, there are liquid muds, there are different rocks and strata. People get nervous about this, and well, should we be doing this? We've done this forever. Humanity has terraformed the ground. We are terraformers of the surface of the earth. We're creative terraformers in every way. There's hardly any of this planet that we haven't moved around to our convenience, to our benefit most of the time. Now a lot of time we're ignoring it now. We don't necessarily see what we could adapt as positive landscaping. But we have more ability now than ever before to use modern equipment to do this incredibly quickly. So your earthworks and earth resources is a chapter of understanding what is possible. And since the manual has been written, which is 1988, Bill wrote the manual, new technology has emerged. So the equipment that we can use has gone further. So we have GPS guided machines now. We have satellite guided machines. Laser levels are very common on machines now. It's almost the norm
on most machinery.
What we can now do to rehabilitate landscape and rehydrate landscape is come down in time scale hundreds of times. So there's a very positive side to this, because as the situation is getting worse and worse, the potential for repair is getting better and better.
Funding the railway.
The timescale now, if we wanted to repair major landscapes, if we applied our resources to them, we could repair in just a few years.
It's awful.
The response is extremely fast, because we're directing water in positive ways. We're linking earthworks together with runoff, soakage, capture. We're making sure that our designs improve the landscape even when energy is switched off. These systems don't stop working. These systems you've got to literally physically remove them. The Roosevelt's wells are still sitting there out in Tucson, Arizona, covered in trees. They weren't even planted. They're still quite stable ecosystems, and no one's really maintaining them. Imagine how much the landscape would improve if we started at top catchment all the way through with positive earthworks, and where we come across good earth resources, putting them to really sensible use.
Hit lag
many
again.
Of you one day realize that when you swale a catchment, eventually you swale and dam a catchment, sooner or later you're going to end up with rampant canals on the side of the hill by default. After 7 years of soakage and rehydration buildup, there's about a 7-year pluming event. It's probably linked to the sun cycle, that your recharge gets to full capacity and doesn't get a lot more from there on. As you come down the landscape, sooner or later, lower down, you're going to put in a soft infiltration swell system, a soakage system, and by default of what's happened above, it turns into a water capture through soakage, through a recharge of spring lines. At that moment, you'll probably look around the landscape and realize, wow, this could be a completely different situation if everybody did this. And you might then realize that we could probably get free energy from compressed air, from falling compressed water at terminal velocity with inputs of air bubbles, so that we get a tromp wherever it's possible in fall. And I've been through that experience, and it was a wonderful thing to look around and realize, oh my goodness, I can see free compressed air out to the landscape. I've got time to go through it now, but just look it up. Look up tromp. Right? Look at Rapid Chute Mine in Canada. Their tromp that's been running for 60 years on simply the fall of water. When you look at what's possible with earthworks out through landscape, by default of our rehydrated landscape, by harmonizing with the shapes in the landscape, by capturing water the right way, by patterning our work with the landscape, we've shown an understanding of that climate. We've shown an understanding of the trees and the ecosystems that then cover that landscape. We've shown an understanding of water and soil creation. The next possibility is that we have surplus water vertically fall. At that point, we're suddenly in a different game. Because compressed air is a very clean energy. And if we have a peak air event, we're in another game. And when you're using compressed air inside your house, you're outgassing fresh air.
Hey, Trump.
And in a lot of circumstances, it's also when you release a gas that's compressed, including air, it's cold.
Simple device was used for hundreds of years to produce compressed air for furnaces, mining
equipment,
there's
a lot of things we want
ventilation systems,
we want to
and
make
even
cold.
Air conditioning.
There's a lot of energy spent
ice production.
Coolness, on cooling
pumps
things down.
Were almost
starts
entirely
replay itself
replaced
in many
with
ways.
Fossil fuels with their high energy potential.
It's not a high tech.
More
there's nothing, there's no, nothing more high tech.
Beginning of the 20th
nothing
century.
Particularly high tech about it. And it was, and the compressed air energy was discovered by the Romans.
The knowledge of these systems is
a long time ago.
Completely forgotten. At the time,
and
the
Andalusian Smiths used
prices,
compressed air in their forges.
Post peak oil.
In southern Spain.
This type of information that needs to be shared.
The USDA is now using it to clean up some of your mine site outfalls in America from iron oxide coming out in rivers. Have a look on YouTube. I'll leave you with that one. Right, from there, you've got all the way through in the manual, you've got to earthworks and earth resources. You're starting to really focus now. You've got a real, your focus has come so much clearer on how you apply design now. Then the manual goes into the three classic climates. And the two of the chapters start with humid. The word humid is humid tropics. And the humid cool to cold climates. Two different humids, but both humid. The rounded landscapes of the tropics, the rounded landscapes of the cool to cold climates. And they're very specific, they're very different. Your house is different, your garden's different, your forest layers are different. It's different design. Your storage of food is completely different. You hardly need to store food in the tropics. It grows in the ground. You hardly need a cupboard. But then the middle chapter in there, the largest chapter in the book, the middle climate starts with the word dry. And it's dry lands. Humid tropics, humid, cool to cold, and dry lands. Dry lands are very complicated. There's a lot of diversity in dry lands. And there's a lot of fertility in dry lands, because nothing decomposes. It just sits there. There's no moisture to make it decompose. There's a lot of airborne nutrient blowing in the air, often ancient. When you work in dry lands, your Brix readings on your crops comes up faster than any other climate. It's some of the healthiest landscape if it's clean. It's some of the dirtiest landscape if you want to industrially grow food in dry lands. You know, it's salts, heavy water use, evaporation, recycling of chemicals and chemicals and chemicals. It just keeps coming at you. Just look at the health records. Just look at the hospital records in dry lands where there's heavy-duty agricultural product. We're the guinea pigs. You can see it in the health records. So, then Bill goes through these climates. He specifically outlines each climate and gives you the reference of how you apply all that design through those climates exactly. And you get not only the housing, the gardens, the forest, the grazing land, the farm forestry, and even the wilderness, you get a whole reference point through those climates. You specifically focus in now. Now you're really getting fine-tuning your focus now. You know exactly where you've referenced into the book. Very, very specific at that point. You'll find in finer details, and you then take that into further reading and further reference today. Further examples today, because the permaculture movement's been putting down systems, and we've been diversifying things beyond imagination in all of those climates. We're coming up with results. I mean, they're out there. They're on the internet. They're obvious. They're not on the internet, they probably don't exist, do they? Why would they not be on the internet? Are you hiding something? Is it secret? Not. Then we go into chapter 13. So we've gone 10, 11, 12. And now chapter 13, aquaculture. It's almost like it should have been in the other chapters, but it's new, it's a rediscovered thing. It's something that wasn't our culture, but it's been removed. The Western English-speaking culture, that is. It's some of the most productive landscape we can ever create. Aquaculture is 30 times more productive in area than land-based protein production, let's say. But also, everything in water is more productive. The fastest growing leaf crop in the world is an aquatic crop. I float it on top of my ponds, floating bamboo islands. Hang Kong, it's a sweet potato genus, Hypermere aquatica. It's a very high quality food, much better for you than any leaf crop you can grow in a garden, like lettuce or something. But it literally floats. You don't need to water it because it's in water. It grows on suspended nutrients. Water is a nutrient solution. Water, aquaculture, is inherently cleaner, potentially, than land-based systems, because water is sensitive to toxins. A lot of water elements can't take heavy toxins. A If anybody's kept a fish tank, you know what happens if you get it wrong. It all dies at once. All the fish are upside down all of a sudden.
Oh, you know what? These probably won't make it to the next year. Whoops.
But water has been removed from the European and American and Western mindset because we overexploited...
Yeah, they won't. Whoops.
...ocean phenomena of fish, particularly the Atlantic cod. Was a phenomenon.
Whoops, I killed everything.
And it was a natural resource that seemed like it was endless. It got completely exploited. And from that, aquaculture has been kind of removed out of our psyche. And when we talk about aquaculture, a lot of time people think we're just talking about fish. But it's everything in water. It's shellfish, it's crayfish, and it's plants. The most productive forage crop in the world comes out of water. Typhus, cattails. The most productive crop by weight in the world is Chinese water chestnut. It's an aquatic crop. In the tropics, because of the instability of the shallow soils and the very heavy rains, only aquatic grain production in rice paddy has ever fed large populations. Because when you're working in the tropics, you have very shallow soils. All the fertility is above the soil. Unless you're in water, where the algae and mud suspend the nutrient. And water has that potential to hold up that fertility for you. But if you go on land-based in the tropics, chances are you're going to degrade the soil down to bedrock, down to subsoil and then to bedrock, where you're really going to go backwards and have to increase the you're going to have to increase the inputs of fertilizer and extra chemicals. So there's a nightmare in the tropics, but the tropics does pioneer itself quickly. It's fragile, but that dry lands are extremely fragile. They're brittle. So your aquaculture is something that we need to then look at.
Quick crop.
What are all the possibilities? We've lost.
What, you say good morning to Shane and not me?
In all its creative forms. There's no department of aquaculture really in many places.
Dick.
It's one of the least fussy areas of agriculture. It's fast growing, it's become quite toxic because people have moved that production potential up very fast and they're still exploiting the ocean to feed aquacultural products. But when you put it into our design, often it's extremely productive with very small amounts of input, even no input at all. Just by positioning elements, we end up with extremely easy production by including aquaculture. So the most productive ecosystem that humanity's ever put together, the Chinampa system, one of the great sustainable systems in history, was the most productive system ever documented. The most productive sustainable system was 50% water minimum. It was the water element that made the difference. So aquaculture is a special subject that we're still exploring. It's something that we're still extending. And cold climates and warm climates all have potential. The wild rice in America here goes all the way from Canada to Florida in variation. And is more productive than
would have been mad
your
if I spent
industrial
100.
Rice production. It's a different species, but it has more production.
If I
it just doesn't
pot only 100,
right all at the same
four
time.
Short. Would have been mad.
But it only takes a small paddling pool to produce enough wild rice, if you harvest over the 30 days that it comes ripe, to feed a small family. It's a typical aquaculture potential. So, from aquaculture as a separate entity, something that we have to be reminded of, unless you're still in one of those countries where there is production of traditional aquaculture, like Southeast Asia. If you're working in Southeast Asia through countries like Vietnam, you'll find there's more fish ponds than there are chicken pens. We have a lot to learn from those people, from their understanding of how they look at their ponds. They can see exactly what's going on. They know the turbidity of the water. They know the color of the water. They know how to understand a pond just from looking at it, in what it needs and what needs to be changed and where they're at in production. So that is a whole rediscovery subject, really. And there's so many references that we are now including. So the final chapter, chapter 14, is like Rubik's Cube, I think, of the manual. Strategies for an Alternative Global Nation. It's about strategies. It's about timing. Oh, I'm sorry, I've missed strategies. I should have said that, right? Here we go, big mistake. Dry land. I should just go backwards 1 second here. Dry land has the word strategies in it. The chapter says dry land strategies. There's a big reason for that. Excuse me. Strategies. It's all about timing. Strategies is not how you do something, but how and when. The strategy of approach in dry lands is crucial. More than the other climates, you have to know exactly when you make your move. You're ready for those events when you get those rare rains and everything has to be captured. You're ready all the time for that timing. So it's a strategy. It's a timing event. Drylands has the word dryland strategies in it. All about timing. Being ready for that time. When it's raining, you should be out there. You should be in it. You should be working with it and staying very closely in tune with those timings. So the final chapter, strategies again for chapter 14 for a global alternative nation. How we work with the invisible structures, how we work with the people systems, how we work with the exchange systems, how we set up village systems and interactions, how we set up the local currency system, how we exchange and barter, how we work with the formal and the informal economies. This is one of the edgiest of all chapters. Beyond pattern, which is the one people have trouble with, this is the other chapter a lot of people have trouble understanding. How we create our communities, how we set up our community land trust systems, how we create a system where we don't have perpetual growth in a finite world or perpetual capital gain in a finite world. How we get into a world where money just doesn't keep going up in value against an exchange rate, where properties go down in price and up in value, where everybody understands how to behave in a way that improves landscape. So having quality land is something that's normal. Having land that's going up in quality rather than degrading in quality but going up in price. How we live, how we set up our communities so we have an understanding of how we interact with each other so that we have meaningful existence. How we start those processes so we share our design experience, so we share our happy little accidents and our sad little failures. How we interact together so that we understand who we can live with Who are your extended family? Who are the 5% people in this room that you could live with? There's probably 1 in 20 in this room that you could live with. That means you know the 19 you couldn't, to drive you nuts. But that's okay, right? As long as you can identify the 1 in 20 you could live with, because right now you can't even do that. What makes a community? How do you actually form a village? How do we resettle the landscape so we can interact together? How do we form, how do we get a common glue? We say, this is what creates a diversity of people. This is what creates an ecosystem of people.
Turnips
when you start to create community action, it's the scariest of all action. Because it's people right in your face. It's where you're going to stand up in amongst people you know and say, I know how we can do it better. There's a system here we can work with. And we can re-identify ourselves. We can even print our own money. We can print our own exchange rate. I mean, as soon as there's any large system collapse, one of the first things we start to do is create our own currencies. It's quite common. When you put people to test on this, they kind of get a bit shaky. But when you look around, if you look around this room, what I see out there, I'm looking at all the faces here, and what I see a typical group of permaculture people. You're all different ages, you're all different backgrounds, a lot of you are different ethnic backgrounds, you're different cultures, you're different life experiences. It'd be really hard to put you guys in one room normally. That's what a group of permaculture people look like. They look like a real mixed up mob. And that's what we are, that's what we have to be. That's what Bill encourages you to be when you read that chapter 14. What he's talking about is getting us back into that tolerance of community. And if you can cooperate around a common theme, if you can just meet under a non-profit community group, if you can put together a system where people meet regularly, 100 people start to meet just once a month, cooperate around what they understand about permaculture effort locally. What has worked and what hasn't worked. Sharing their failures, sharing their successes, sharing seeds, sharing species, sharing designs, sharing building techniques. And if you do that for 5 years, you know exactly who you can settle land with. You've identified everybody that's in your tribe. Know who they are. And the other thing you've done is you've terrified the local politicians. As soon as a local politician walks into a room like this and sees you guys looking like you are now, they see 20 people in the local community represented by every person in this room. And they're looking political death in the eye. If they don't understand what you stand for, you just look at page 510 on chapter 14 in the manual, the bioregional resources listed. I put it together as a fractal because I couldn't understand it as a list. I had to see it as a mind map so I could teach it. It works globally. It's exactly what you'd love your local politician, your local government system to do for you. But they're not likely to do it, are they? It's going to make you more independent. It's probably going to make you ask them to serve you, which is kind of something like democracy is supposed to be. We vote people in who say they're going to do something for us, and they do something else. If you look at that page 510, chapter 14, the bioregional resources, you'll see a list of exactly what you'd need to know when you want to resettle landscape anywhere on this planet. It'll work anywhere. I've put it together through 30 different countries in many different languages. And I haven't found anybody that says, this doesn't work, this works. Bill gave us that system to identify what it is we need to know to make this whole thing that much easier. And the very, very last thing Bill puts in the manual, the very last subset there in chapter 14, is appropriate aid in the developing world. Appropriate aid in the developing world is exactly what we have to offer the developing world. But they still have plenty to offer us as well. Okay.
Did get me thinking. Hey, I should make my own money. That's where the money's at. Make your own money. Give you 5 observer bucks to go down on me. Boom. Free BJs. And they say, oh, well, I want to redeem observer bucks for you giving me food, and I'm like, nah, it doesn't work like that. That's still not a disgustingly large amount of money, though. I need to expand. I'm gonna quit now, but I need to expand my garden. I might want to invest in scarecrows. And I still need more of these barrels. Because I don't like waiting 2 days. I'd much rather do it all in one day. And then wait however many days it takes for the stuff to ripen, which I think for corn it's 2 days. Oh well, that was enough playing for today. Thank you for watching, goodbye. Hope you have a wonderful day, night, whatever.